All right, you know, I've jabbered on for a while. So now's your chance to ask questions, and someone asked me a question, I'll actually start it off. Ask about, because a lot of the guides get questions about slaves in the church. And it is a very difficult question to answer because we have different answers from different places. In some locations, there is evidence that slaves were welcome and invited into the church. That means they either stood, sat in windowsills, or in the aisles in these churches. They weren't given pews, except I know, for example, in Norfolk, there was a pew that was painted black that was reserved in the back. And we also know from other denominations that the dispossessed, the slaves, the apprentices, the landless who did not get seats would always be allowed to sit at best in the back perimeters of the buildings. Oftentimes in New England, in congregational meeting houses, that means the very back benches in the galleries. Occasionally, there were galleries that were built specifically for slaves and free blacks, but not as much as you would think and have probably heard. There is a church, there's an Anglican church in St. Mary's County, Maryland, that clearly was intended for slaves because there was no direct entrance into that gallery except from the outside. And of course, if you looked at my book, I found out that and made sense that there was in the 19th century, in 1852, a gallery that was built in the north wing of the church for slaves, with an exterior entrance that you see a couple of images in that book. And so the question is, when they took communion, they would have to come outside down that enclosed staircase, out and around and back into the church. Another church that happened, an 18th century church, is St. Peter's Church in New Kent County. We have Civil War photographs to thank for this because you'll see a staircase running up beneath the tower that goes directly into the gallery, and that obviously was for blacks to be seated. But in general, and in some places it's very explicit, for example, at St. Michael's Church in Charleston, there were complaints of poor whites that they could not get any seats or any places to put their stools inside the church because of slaves, and the vestry pastor rule saying that slaves have to be in the bell tower, that is, in the entrance to that church, not even in the sanctuary. Other places, it's possible that they were sitting along the back wall. What happened in Bruton, I don't know. I just can't tell you. They're certainly not sitting in galleries, except it's possible, you know, I don't know this, but you've probably heard of the Gray School that was established here in 1760 or so. And there's one of the requirements was to take those children to church. And so the question is, where did they sit? And if they were seated in the church, then they probably did sit somewhere in that south gallery, not the one in the wing, but the south gallery where those grammar school boys were. That's a possibility, but we don't know that. If you can find the answer, that'd be great. That's the other frustrating part of this research, is the Reverend McCabe, who took the vestry book home with him to work on it down in Norfolk, and it burned up, transcribed a lot of great things, but he didn't write down everything. And there could have been a lot more in that book, I'm sure there was. So, are there any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned a partition.
Yes.
Across the top. What was behind where the altar and the parpios are now?
That's where the Sunday school was, in the West End.
Okay.
Sunday school lecture hall is where they're meeting. When they tore it down in 1905, they found a couple of books saying who attended Sunday school in 1832. And they also found a couple of cannonballs. But that's where it was. And the tower, the bottom of the tower is where they stored the coal. It was a coal bin. So they didn't even enter the church through the west at that time. Yes?
Wasn't there a door opened at the east end?
Yes, there was a door opened at the east end in 1849. Not 1839 when it got reoriented, but in 10 years later. And you can see it in a very easily and very nicely in a watercolor that I have in my book done by Cranston, who came through here. Now, how was it used? I don't know. I know that one of the ministers had to do a lecture about people making noises and cutting up outside that door in the 1870s. Now, were they schoolboys? Were they the usual suspects, as they say, in Casablanca? I don't know. But that's not a primary door. That's a tertiary door. When the building was rearranged in 1839 until 1907, the main doorways were the south door and the north door in the wings. Those were the ways that you got into the church. So it's sort of sideways. Now, yes, sir.
How much of the undercroft, how far back does that go?
It's all modern. I mean, for me, modern is anything after 1800, but it was only created as a place to put heating systems in the very late 19th century, and then it was expanded in 1905 and then expanded even further in 1938-39. But you know, in the 18th century there was just burials there. There's no undercroft. There's no need to have an undercroft. There's no crypt or anything like that. Yes, sir.
How long did the hanging gallery remain?
Until 1839.
Well, they were taken down.
They were taken down in 18, except for the West Gallery for, a very, you would think that would have been gone too, not because of the school boys, but the college boys, but you would think they would have taken all of them down, but they took those other four down. And so, what you see today with those nice south wing and north wing galleries never existed until 1939.
So were those side galleries connected with the West Gallery? Was it all of one piece, or were they completely separate?
They were separate. I spent a lot of time looking at all those balusters, and they're all real. And that's a modern technical term saying they're old. So there's no way that you the handrail also is unbroken. So they had a separate doorway, separate staircases in both of those. So you had one, two, three, four, you had four stairs in this thing. So so every time you have a stair, you're taking away ground floor seating by doing that.
Interesting. I wondered if it had functioned or it looked like the galleries at Trinity Newport.
No.
How it's sort of a big.
Yeah. No, it's nothing like that. You'd think it would be, but I guess they wanted that segregation. They want those college boys and those grammar school boys.
Did it actually seat that many more people, or with all these columns to hold all this stuff up, did you cut lose so many seats?
Well, you do lose seats.
A bunch of sub seats.
Yeah, you lose seats, but that's why they were expensive in the. For example, Benjamin Waller had to pay for it, and John Hollowell had to pay for his private. It's a very high status symbol kind of thing, and you paid for it because you were taking away people's seats below, and you're inconveniencing them. Sometimes in other vestry books that you see throughout Virginia, they say you can do it if you don't incommode, but you are. You're going to incommode them, and I don't know if you paid them or something for taking them. they're part of the benchway.
So it would it have doubled or 50% more seating than maybe what?
It would be considerably more, and that's the part why I had the drawing done, to get a sense of just how many more people you could get up there. So you could get a lot more people. I don't think it doubled it, but you got a lot more than are there now. And you know, by 1829, those are empty, and it really does look forlorn. Yes, sir.
The stone floor that's there now, when did that go?
That went in 1938-39. There was the 1905-07 restoration put marble in, and that was all taken up. There's not stone there in 1716, but it is there by the 1740s. So there is, and they found bits of it in 1905 when they were doing, and it was a white Purbeck limestone from the Dorset area. And much of that Purbeck is used in Christopher Wren's churches. It's very easily workable, nice white color, relatively durable as well. And we find it still all over the place. In fact, the recent excavations at the college where they found the brew house, but right next to it was a salt pit. And there is this white Purbeck stone that was thrown in after the fire in 1705. So the geologist tells us. So it was, as you can imagine, it's expensive to import it from England. So not everyone had it. Yes, ma'am.
Did Bruton Parish have anything like that?
No, nothing like that. So the question is, where did the vestry meet? A tavern? the second place is sometimes they build vestry houses. So a few of them still survive. There was one in Maryland at St. Paul's in Kent County. On the Eastern Shore, it's 1766 because they put the numbers on it. It makes it easy. And you know, it would be 12 by 15 feet and heated, and that's where they would meet. Sometimes, if you had a tower, they might meet in the tower, although at Bruton, that's not the case. But just recently, this year, at Jamestown, the church tower, and we've been working on and making sure it doesn't fall down. And the brick mason discovered slots on the second floor of that tower where there were benches that went across three sides of it for the vestry to meet. So we finally, I was excited. So you can see my excitement level.
Folks, I think we better hold more questions for the social hour afterwards.
Yeah, I'd be happy to answer any afterwards.
Carl,
as well.
Get your book signed and ask all your questions, but we need to move on to hear what Linda has to tell us tonight. So, thank you, Carl.
Thank you.
All
right. Well, it's a pleasure to be here, and I appreciate your regrouping here to continue. So it's great to see you all. What I'm going to try to do is evoke a service in 1770 Bruton Parish Church. We don't have a full account of a whole service, so I put together things from different sources to try to help us imagine what it would have been like to attend a service on any given Sunday in Williamsburg in Bruton Parish Church in the 1770s. Just a quick note about Bruton Parish itself. Remember that the parish of Bruton was about 10 miles square. That was James Blair's estimate in 1724. That means it would have included the whole city of Williamsburg, but also a good chunk of rural areas from York County and James City County. So the people gathering at the church on Sunday mornings would have included town dwellers and people who lived on farms or perhaps large plantations in the rural area, but also a mix of people, rural and urban, well-to-do, not so well-to-do. The whole gamut would have been gathering at the church. The rector in 1770 is the Reverend James Horrocks. He was born in England in Yorkshire. He He had had contact with Virginians before he came to Virginia in 1761 as a member of the faculty and later the headmaster of Wakefield School in Yorkshire. And so some of his students included Robert Beverly, Theodoric Bland, and Richard Henry Lee. So by the time he arrived in Virginia, he had some contact with Virginia families. He married a local girl, one of the daughters of Thomas Everard. It was said of him that he knew how to curry favor with the right people. So he soon was named as he first came to Petchworth Parish in Gloucester County, was soon named the master of the grammar school at William and Mary, and not long after that was named president of the college. Following on that, he assumed the rectorship at Bruton. Was named to the governor's council, which made him a judge of the general court, and was also the chaplain at the public jail. And so he had quite an accumulation of positions to his name. Also, it's interesting to note that in Williamsburg itself, I often jokingly say that within the environs of Williamsburg, there are more ordained Church of England clergy than anywhere else you can think of in Virginia and perhaps many other places. Because remember, the faculty, president and faculty at the college, except for one, are ordained ministers of the Church of England. Nearby parishes, James City Parish, Yorkhampton Parish and Charles Parish in York County, and several other nearby parishes, all have clergy that from time to time fill in for one another. So for example, when Horrocks left to go to Europe, ostensibly for his health in the early 1770s, Samuel Henley from the college filled in for him until a permanent minister was named. So that kind of exchange is kind of interesting to think about too, that they were subbing for each other. And a number of the faculty at the college were ministers at the church on the Main, where James City Parish parishioners were meeting from the 1750s. But to get back to Sunday morning, any given Sunday morning in Williamsburg at Bruton Parish Church, the service usually began at 11 in the warmer months, at 12 in the colder months. Seems to be kind of a rule of thumb in Virginia. It also depends on local custom. There was no hard and fast rule about that. These relatively late hours gave people time to get to church from more distant locations within these parishes, which were much larger parishes than you might find in England, for example. The churchyard, as I'm sure you've heard on more than one occasion, was the gathering place. People could arrive on their fine horses, in their fine carriages, to make a kind of an impression as they arrived. But eventually all classes would have been milling around the churchyard, which was a sacred place in one way because of the burials, the funerals, the gravestones there. But it's also a place where people know that they are likely to see people that they know, members of their families, extended families perhaps. They can exchange news. There are many notices that might be posted in the churchyard. Here we have that combination of church and state that's just seamless at this time. Government announcements of elections, and we'll get to more of these in just a moment, but several things like that, proclamations of different types, might be read in church, but also posted on the church door or somewhere in the churchyard, so you can avail yourself of those kinds of, that kind of important information as well. The church was also a very important place of spiritual support and renewal, of course. That gathering in the churchyard does not diminish the other aspect of Bruton Parish Church and other parish churches in Virginia, in my opinion. The Sunday morning worship service that you encountered most frequently in the 18th century was the service of morning prayer. Communion was celebrated infrequently, perhaps three, four, or five times a year. So the service that you're going to encounter on Sunday morning is morning prayer. And something that will strike you right away is that there's no procession as the service begins. In Bruton, because it had an organ and an accomplished organist, perhaps there was some music prelude there. We don't know that for certain. We know that Peter Pelham practiced the great composer, so perhaps there was that kind of thing going on. As the service begins, in one account, this is not for Bruton specifically, but at a nearby parish, the leading men of the parish waited outside while everyone else went in and got seated, and they kind of went in as a body, an impressive body, I'm sure. They might have been followed by the rector himself, who, as he traversed the aisle from the door toward the pulpit area, might have stopped to greet people, possibly, ask about someone who had been ill. That's a possibility. When he reached the desk area, some accounts say that the rector would don his surplice then in full view of the congregation, and so that too would be a difference. If that was carried out in churches, that would be a difference for us as well. As I say, there's no procession with a crucifer, no vested choir in Bruton Parish Church, and so those kinds of things would stand out to you right away. The service of morning prayer in the 18th century prayer book that we use at Colonial Williamsburg has an interesting rubric right at the beginning. It says, at the beginning of morning prayer, the minister shall read with a loud voice some one or more of the following sentences of scripture. So all through the prayer book rubrics for morning prayer, it's reiterated that the minister should speak in a loud voice. As Carl said, this was an oral or an auditory experience. Not everybody was facing forward. Not everybody could read. If you had a prayer book, you probably brought it with you if you wanted to follow the service. But if you couldn't read or didn't own a prayer book, then you were listening. And so the minister was admonished to speak clearly. The same went for the clerk, the clerk, and the reader as well. Morning prayer continues with many of the elements of service that we are familiar for us today. The music of the church, though, as you probably have heard, is very different from what we would think today. The writing of hymns had just become in vogue about 1700 or 1705. Those were considered products of the human mind, the human pen, human thought. The psalms, set to poetry and metered music, were considered to be sacred because they were coming directly from the Bible. So that kind of congregational singing, where the clerk is lining out, singing out a line, and then the congregation sings it back, is another experience that would be very different from what we think of today with the hymns that are so near and dear and have been for so many generations. We hardly can think that they were ever considered secular or not, you know, not religious, but because they are, but not, they're not drawn directly from Scripture. The first and second lessons follow on the Psalms. Here's another very big difference, though. Following the second lesson, and this is in one of your handouts, I'll refer to your handouts, although I'm not going to go through them line by line. There's a law mentioned in your compilation there where I say the church is a center of communication, the first one. The law passed by the General Assembly designates that a copy of the law to suppress insurrections by slaves is to be purchased by the parish. The church wardens are to acquire a copy at the cost of the parish. It's to be written into the register, and twice a year is to be read following the second lesson. here is something that's not religious in any way. So again, that connection, seamless connection of church and state. Following the reading of the second lesson, you read a law that has to do with suppressing slave insurrections. I imagine that other proclamations and announcements could be made at that same point, although some of the other laws in your handout designate that the minister should read them out at the church door after the service, and perhaps then post them in the churchyard, that sort of thing. One of the big things was to notice when the governor called a new election of the House of Burgesses, the church and the courthouse were the two places, public places, that those notices should be posted. So they were sent out all over the colony. One of my favorite proclamations by one of the governors early in the 18th century called for a day of prayer and fasting in thanksgiving for deliverance from a plague of caterpillars. You can just see that red from, you know, from the pulpit in Bruton. Don't know that that happened, but I'd like to think it did. The other thing that you would notice is that, of course, there were prayers for the King's Majesty and for the royal family. As we know, as the revolution approached, the Virginia Convention, the House of Delegates began to suggest other wording for those prayers. At first, they suggested the magistrates, not meaning judges, but all public officials of the independent Commonwealth of Virginia, that the prayers be said for them. And after the U.S. Constitution was ratified, we know that John Bracken is probably in John Bracken's hand, that one of the prayer books owned by Bruton has those prayers marked out, and the President of the United States or President of the U.S. substituted. So it wasn't until the 1790, I believe it was, that the first American prayer book was published in the United States. So they had to make some adjustments in order to keep using the older prayer books. If I could back up for just a moment, once the service of morning prayer ended, usually the litany, which is a kind of a general supplication, it's in our prayer books as well as the 18th century ones, usually followed on morning prayer. And then the first part of the communion service through the reading of the gospel. And so the service from the Book of Common Prayer is rather lengthy at that time. There's some discussion about whether these services went on for a lot longer than we think about it, and they probably did, given the amount of material from the Book of Common Prayer that's covered. As far as the sermons themselves are concerned, and I have included in your handouts a sermon by William Dawson. It bears the date 1732. He was probably assisting James Blair in the last years of Blair's life, sometimes preached for him. And you'll see in the notations on that sermon that he preached it again every 4 years, so he used this one over and over. It's rather succinct. Sermons in parish churches have a reputation of being lengthy and boring, not accessible by the average person. This one in particular is a little dry, but he obviously feels strongly about not being too self-indulgent at Christmas time and so forth and so on. So I think the lessons of his sermon are quite clear. It's interesting to note, though, in this transcription here, you can see where he's done some editing. He's marked out some things and started over. You can kind of see him shuffling his papers in the pulpit, perhaps, as he goes through this sermon. So I just wanted you to have that, since I knew it was one that had been preached in Williamsburg on more than one occasion. Philip Fithian is, some of you are familiar with, the tutor at Nomini Hall for the Carter family, wrote that the minister at the parish church where he attended was very mindful of the length of sermon that the parishioners preferred. I think sermons in New England and perhaps some of the evangelical denominations could go on for much longer. And certainly published sermons appear to be very lengthy. I'm not sure that all of that was presented at one time in some of the services. So that is the what you would have encountered in Bruton Parish Church on most Sundays. With the sermon complete and the dismissal and a few prayers at the end, the minister might proceed to the door of the church, read announcements if they had come his way that week, and then he would probably join the meeting and greeting in the churchyard himself. The other thing I wanted to talk a little bit about, and I've got one of your handouts, talks about Sunday do's and don'ts. The general approach to Sundays in 18th century Virginia was followed a long tradition of designating what was appropriate for Sunday. Travel was often included in these laws, travel to church and back. But unless there were cases of necessity, you weren't to do other traveling. Work was often eschewed on Sundays. The General Assembly passed several laws along these lines. I thought one of the more interesting was that they prevented sheriffs from standing at the door of the church to issue writs, knowing that they could find people at church. They were and issue these writs. But if you were accused of murder or treason, you could still be handed your writ at the church door. So always a few exceptions. You know, there's some talk about taverns, you'll see in this layout here, about strong drink on Sunday, and yet the taverns are open. They're the hotels of the 18th century. So they're talking about moderation, perhaps, but there's always a little bit of a caveat or a way to wiggle room on these things. We know that many people in Virginia, contrary to what has been thought in the past, they were very serious about attending church. Even William Byrd in his diaries, this is a little bit earlier in the century to be sure, but when he's in Williamsburg attending the assembly, on Sundays he goes to church, or if he doesn't make it to church, he does some reading of scripture in Greek and Latin and so forth in his room wherever he's staying. So they seem to take the day seriously. At the same time, in the afternoons, there might be, horse races or games or other amusements of that sort. So it's kind of a balancing act between those things. Keep in mind that the attendance laws are on the books. The 18th century people are to attend church, the parish churches, once a month, once in 4 weeks. There weren't any membership rolls taken or attendance rolls, but the two church wardens, members of the parish, it was kind of a face-to-face society. They knew when people weren't turning up for extended times. They would appear for the prosecution in the county courts before the grand jury. And if the grand jury saw the charges held water, shall we say, then they were bound over to be tried in court for not attending church. And if convicted, were subject to fines that were paid to the parish churches for helping with the upkeep of the poor. So I guess my main points this evening are that Bruton Parish Church and the other 100 parishes in Virginia by the time of the Revolution were certainly points where people knew they would see people, and they had this impetus of the laws, but I still think people were probably going voluntarily. It's hard to say how many and how often, but it seems to me that these laws that are communicated in church is one of the places that you find out what the government is saying. It means that people are going. They knew that people would see these things. So there's that aspect of it. It's there for spiritual support. I think all ranks of society might have felt a temporary sense of community when they pray for a relief from, you know, protection from pestilence, pray for peace, pray for forgiveness of sins. There might be a shared sense of community in this hierarchical society that we're existing in at that time. So that's another aspect of it. And the fact that Sunday was intended to be kept holy and Sabbath breaking was frowned upon, even if it was a little bit local custom and so forth, allowed people some movement in those areas. I guess I'll finish up there. And Carl and I can take some questions, but thank you for your attention.
Were there any non-Anglicans in the parish?
Yes. The question is, were there any non-Anglicans in Bruton Parish? The answer is yes. Actually, there were non-Anglicans in Virginia from the middle of the 17th century. There were laws passed against bringing Quakers in and so forth. In York County in the 1680s, there were Quakers that were influencing slaves and so forth, and they were noted in court records. But in 1765, a group of Presbyterians in Williamsburg petitioned the county court to be allowed to meet in a house in Williamsburg on the George Davenport property. their meeting house is part of the historic area now. So, yes, they were in Williamsburg. Interestingly, their marriages were supposed to be legal, or to be performed by C of E ministers. They were still liable for church taxes to the parish, partly because of the support for the poor only came from the parishes, so that was considered a community responsibility. So it was kind of a gray area. They were not supposed to serve in public office. Church of England was the preferred religion for officials at that time. So yes, we do have. And we have Baptists here too, Gowan pamphlets. Black Baptist Church got started in the last quarter of the 18th century. Evangelical itinerants influenced whites and blacks alike. And Pamphlet is one of the interesting figures of the 18th century who began to preach to a congregation and eventually identified as a Baptist. So, what else? Yes.
I know you sort of offhandedly referred to the length of the service, but if someone asks you, which they ask us all the time in the church, how long are the services?
I saw an estimate yesterday from a historian of the church in Virginia who said it might have gone on for 75 minutes, perhaps 90 minutes, maybe longer if it was the communion, the full-blown communion service. It's just very hard to tell, but it wouldn't surprise me if it weren't a little bit longer. 75 minutes seems like a reasonable estimate to me. I don't know that we can say for certain. Does that help you?
It does, and gives me a frame of reference, because we are asked that a lot.
Right. The amount of material that could be included from the prayer book for morning prayer, that whole service, it could take up considerable time. And so, depending on the length of the sermon, I think it probably varied a little bit.
Was the prayer book fairly similar to what we have now?
You would be surprised at how familiar it sounds. Yes, it's not exactly the same, but it's a lot of the material would be very familiar to you. And there are, I meant to bring a couple tonight. I'm sorry, I forgot it. We have Ann brought some last time. I don't remember that tonight. But there are 18th century prayer books around. I read plenty of Williamsburg and other places. You can also access them online. So you might do that just to see how the wording is. Yes.
Did they only have one service on Sunday, and did they have other services during the rest of the week?
That's a good question. The question is, did they have only one service on Sundays, or did they have other services during the week? In many parish churches in Virginia, there was a service in the morning and the afternoon. Now, at Bruton, that seems to have taken the afternoon service, if I can use that word, seems to have taken the form of a lecture, subscription lectures, or lecture-type presentations by various ones of this plethora of clergy that I mentioned earlier. So, and I've heard it complained of in one document that the people who lived out in the country couldn't very well return in the afternoon. That would be two long trips, or somehow managing to stay in town. So, but certainly there were special services on Christmas, certain saints' days. We know from John Blair's diaries and so forth that he went on Michaelmas, Candlemas. He expressed an opinion about the quality of the sermons. Some women do that too. It's not just the men. The law required men and women of 21 years and over to repair to their parish churches once in 4 weeks, once a month. Begs the question about women who might have infants, but no servants or slaves. Not sure about whether there were babes in arms in church. It wouldn't surprise me. There are no laws in Virginia preventing children from being in church, but were they? Carl mentioned the grade school students, the college students. There are prescriptive literature out there for young people, prescribes behavior in church. No, don't. Keep your mind on the prayer book and the sermon, and off people's finery that are sitting next to you. So I think there were young people in church. We just don't have a really good idea of how that worked and what it might have meant for mothers who were without help and with young children. Yes, Carol.
I know some of us do mention the infant mortality rate.
Yes.
As something that kept mothers from bringing young children.
There were acceptable excuses for not going to church, and I think everyone would have understood not bringing infants out in the cold, particularly if they were sickly already. But the weather conditions, the conditions of the roads, illness, were all seem to have been acceptable excuses for missing church more than you might normally have. So it's strict, and yet it's flexible. But I agree with you, the infant mortality. And women in childbirth would not venture out right away either. So, all right, any other questions for Carl? Well, thank you so much for coming.
So, everyone, there will be some refreshments in the back. Hang around for a while, have some refreshments. Buy your book from Dudley, get it signed by Carl, and thank you for coming out.
Thank you.
I did. I just spoke. I'm going to read a book. I'm going to read a book.